हेलो फ्रेंड, दिस इज डॉक्टर आर पी एस चौहान, प्रोफेसर एंड हेड डिपार्टमेंट इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स एंड कम्युनिकेशन इंजीनियरिंग एट आई एम एस इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज गाजियाबाद। आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन माई न्यू लेक्चर। टूडे इन माई लेक्चर आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द कॉल इंस्ट्रक्शन, द इनपुट आउटपुट पोर्ट प्रोग्रामिंग एंड द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ टाइमर ऑफ 8051 माइक्रो कंट्रोलर। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट द कॉल इंस्ट्रक्शन। सो द कॉल इंस्ट्रक्शन इज मेनली यूज टू कॉल ए सब रूटीन इन ए मेन प्रोग्राम। सो बिफोर डिस्कसिंग द कॉल इंस्ट्रक्शन let us discuss the subroutine. What is subroutine? Subroutine is nothing but it is a small program, and this small program is also called the subroutine in the assembly language. So this subroutine is nothing but it is a small program, and it is used in a main it is called in a main program to perform a particular task repeatedly. Example of this subroutine is delay subroutine and the display subroutine. Generally we use delay. If you want to generate a certain amount of delay, then we generate this delay with the help of this subroutine. And another example is display subroutine. If you want to display something on the display device, so we use the display subroutine. So for this calling this subroutine, we use a call instruction in 8051 microcontroller. So call instruction is used to call a subroutine. Subroutine are often used to perform tasks that need to be performed frequently. This makes a program more structured in addition to saving memory space. So this is the advantage of using the subroutine. So here, if you want to perform a certain program frequently or repeatedly, so we use this subroutine, and this way we makes a program more structured and also will save the memory space. The example of call instruction is LCALL, that is long call instruction. It is a 3-byte instruction. The first byte is the operation code. Second and third bytes are used for address of target subroutine. Subroutine is located anywhere within 64 kilobytes of address space. So these are the certain points which are related with the LCALL, that is long call subroutine, long call instruction. Next is the ACALL, that is absolute call instruction. So absolute call instruction is the 2-byte instruction. The 11 bits are used for address within 2 kilobytes range. So this is required to remember, in absolute call we use 11 bits which are used for address within 2 kilobytes range. Let's see the LCALL instruction. When subroutine is called, control is transferred to that subroutine. The processor saves on the stack the address of the instruction immediately below the LCALL instruction. So whenever the LCALL instruction is executed by the microcontroller, the controller will transfer the control from the main program to the subroutine. So before transferring the control from main program to subroutine, it is essential that the next instruction of after LCALL will be the address of the next instruction after the LCALL can be saved into the reserved portion of memory called stack. So whenever the subroutine is executed, the last instruction of each and every subroutine is the return instruction. So whenever microcontroller execute the RET instruction, it will return back into the main program by picking the returning address from the reserved portion of the memory, that is called the stack. So this is actual structure. When we use the subroutine in the main program, the processor or the controller will transfer the control from main program to subroutine, execute the subroutine, execute the return instruction. It will pick the returning address from the stack and return back into the main program. Begins to fetch instruction from the new location. After finishing execution of the subroutine, the instruction RET transfer control back to the caller. That is, every subroutine needs RET as the last instruction. So this is very, very important point. RET instruction is always be the last instruction of each and every subroutine. So the example of this LCALL instruction. So see here, this program will explain how this subroutine, that is delay subroutine, we have this delay subroutine, and the subroutine will start. This is the delay subroutine. See here, this is the subroutine. So this is nothing but the main program. So in main program, the first instruction is move A comma 55H. With the help of this instruction, load the content of accumulator, load accumulator with 55. Then move P1 comma A, send 55 to port P1. So the content of accumulator is copied into the port P1. Then we use this LCALL delay instruction. So this delay is nothing but it is a delay subroutine. So see here, with the help of this LCALL instruction, we can call a subroutine that is called the delay subroutine, which is nothing. It is used to generate a certain amount of delay. Then the second number, that is 0AAH, which is copied into the accumulator. Then it is again transferred to port P1. Then again we call a delay subroutine. So after certain amount of delay, the controller will transfer the value, that is 55, to P1 and the AAH into the port P1. So it will, or we can say that it will toggle the port, each bit of the port, by 55 and AA. So once this instruction is executed with the help of this L call instruction, a subroutine is called, which brings which start from this particular memory location. So here the instruction which is used to provide the certain amount of delay. So here we need to load this register R5 with a value that is 255, which is the maximum value which can be loaded, and the instruction DJNZ R5 will decrement the content of register R5, and it will check the content of register R5 whether it is 0 or not. So it will provide the required amount of delay. So see here, each subroutine will consist RET instruction at the last instruction. So whenever this RET instruction is executed, it will pick the returning address, the address of these instructions from the stack, and return back into the main program. So this is the use of the L call instruction. Now, difference between the L call and the absolute call, the only difference between A call and L call is the target address for L call can be anywhere within 64 kilobytes of address. The target address of A call must be within 2 kilobytes of the range. So this is the main difference between the long call and the absolute calls. Here the target address within anywhere, that is 64 kilobytes, but here it is within the range of 2 kilobytes. So this is the very important point which is required to remember, and with the help of this we can able to differentiate this A call and L call. Use of A call instead of L call can save number of bytes of program, that is ROM space. So with the help of this, we can able to save the number of bytes of the program or the ROM space. So see the program which will explain or which will differentiate the L call and the A call instruction. The program here, in this program we use this L call instruction to call a delay subroutine, and in this second program we use this A call absolute call instruction to call a delay subroutine. So here the program is used, this is the same as the previous program. Here with the help of this program, the content of A is copied into the P1 register, that is port P1, and the L call, which is the subroutine, the L call instruction is used to call a subroutine. But in this second program, the A call instruction is used to call a delay subroutine, and here instead of using this move P1 comma A, and again, so here CPL instruction is used, which will directly complement the content of accumulator. So previously the content of accumulator is 55, and after using this CPL instruction, it will make the content of accumulator is AAH. So this way we can use the same program with the help of the L call and A call instruction. Next is the input output port programming. So in 8051 microcontroller we have the 4 8-bit port, that is port 0, port 1, port 2, port 3, and we have port 0, port 1, port 2, and port 3. So these are 4 8-bit ports. The following code will continuously send out to port 0 the alternate value, that is 55 and AA. So here how the input output port programming can be done with the help of the assembly language programming. So here move A comma 55H, with the help of this instruction the content, that is the 55, the immediate data is copied into the accumulator. So after the execution, the A is equals to 55H. Then the content of accumulator is copied into this P0. So P0 is equals to A is equals to 55H with the help of this instruction. Then we use this A call instruction to call a delay. Then move A comma hash 0AAH. So this 0 will indicate that after this the digits or the letter which belongs to a hexadecimal number instead of a character. That's why we put or insert 0 before this letter A. Then it will transfer the content of accumulator, which is 0AA, to the port P0. Then again we use this A call delay and SJMP back. So it will transfer the control, or it will provide the short jump to the target, which is the back. So this way we can able to perform the input output programming by transferring the content of accumulator after certain amount of time delay, which is generated by A call delay subroutine. In order to make port 0 an input port, the port must be programmed by writing 1 to all the bits. So, if you want to make port P1 as an input port, so we send 1 to all the bits of the port. Suppose if you want to make port P1 as an input or port 0 as an input port, so then we send that FF to the port P0 with the help of the instruction, that is MOV A comma hash 0FFH. So, port 0 is configured first as an input port by writing 1s to it, and then data is received from that port and sent to P1. So, what is the requirement? If you want to receive the data from any port, or if you want to configure any port as an input port, first send the FFH to port P0 to make all the port P0 as a input port. So, with the help of instruction MOV A comma hash 0FFH, A is equals to FFH, and copy or transfer this content of accumulator into this P0. With the help of this instruction, we can able to configure port P0 as a input port by writing it all once. So, all the bits of port 0 will consist the 1, or we can write the 1 to all the corresponding bit of port P0. Then, once the port P0 is configured as an input port, it is ready to receive the data. So, the data which is input is copy to the accumulator with the help of instruction MOV A comma P0 and from A to port P1. So, this is the requirement. With the help of, once we receive the data with the port P0 as input port, then after receiving or transferring this data from input port to the accumulator, it will copy the data into the P1 and perform the short jump to the target. So, this way we can able to make or configure the port P0 as an input port, receive the data from input port and transfer it to the port P1. Next is port 1 can be used as input or output. In contrast to port 0, this port does not need any pull-up resistor since it already has pull-up resistor internally. Upon reset, port 1 is configured as input port. The following code will continuously send out to port P0 the alternate value, that is 55 and AAH. So, here the port P1 is used to configure the port 1 same as that of the port P0. So, if you want to make port 1 as a input port, so configure this port 1 by sending 0FFH to this, and with the help of this program, the content of accumulator A is equals to 55, then transfer this A to this P1, then call a delay, complement the content of accumulator and perform the sub jump or execute this short jump instruction to transfer the control to the target label, which is nothing but the back to this particular memory location. So, this program will toggle the content of accumulator or the bit of P1 after certain amount of delay. So, the bit of P1 is toggled, means the 0 bit is replaced by 1 and 1 is replaced by 0. To make port 2 as an input port, it must be programmed as such, writing by 1 to all the bits. In many 8051 based system, P2 is used as a simple input output port, but in 8031 based system, port P2 must be used along with port P0 to provide the 16 bit address for the external memory. So, here we do not have the program memory in 8031 microcontroller. So, we need to connect external memory with this 8031 microcontroller. So, when we connect external memory with the 8031 microcontroller, then here the port P2 is used along with port P0 to carry the data and the address for the memory. So, port 2 is also designated as A8 to A15 address line, indicating it is a dual function. Port 0 provide the lower 8 bit address on A0 to A7 address lines. Sometimes we need to access only 1 or 2 bits of the port. So, in 8051 the ports are bit addressable means we can able to set or reset the individual bit of the port. So, this is called the bit addressable. This is the meaning of bit addressable. So, with the help of this instruction CPLP 1.2, so we can complement the bit 2 of port P1 with the help of this instruction, that complement P1.2, call a delay subroutine, then provide a short jump to the target level. Then another variation of the above program is set B P1.2, A called delay, clear P1.2, A called delay, and jump again. So this is the two example through which we can able to perform the complement operation. We can complement the individual bit of this port 1 second bit with the help of this program, the CPL P1.2, or we can set B P1.2 and clear P1.2 instruction. So this is the program through which we can able to perform the bit manipulation operation with this port. Then write the following program which create a square wave of 50% duty cycle on bit 0 of port 1. So the 50% duty cycle means that on and off state or the high and low portion of the pulse have the same length. Therefore, we toggle P1.0 with a time delay in between each state. So 50% duty cycle means the on time and the off time of the square wave, which is same, which is equal. So T on is equals to T off, then only we can able to provide the 50% duty cycle. So here in this program, the following program which will explain how to generate this square wave of 50% duty cycle. The first instruction is set B P1.0. With the help of this instruction, we can set the 0 bit of port P1. So set to high bit 0 of port 1. Then we use this L call delay subroutine with the help of this instruction, L call instruction, long call instruction. So call the delay subroutine. So it will transfer the control from the main program to the subroutine, which is delay subroutine, execute the subroutine and return back into the main program to this particular memory location. So once it will return back, it will clear P1.0. So previously the bit P1.0 is set to high. With the help of this instruction, clear P1.0, see P1.0 becomes 0. Then again we call a subroutine with the help of this instruction, L call delay subroutine. So then the microcontroller will again transfer the control from the main program to the subroutine. It will execute the subroutine and return back into the next instruction, that is SJMP, and it will provide the short jump to the target address, which is the HERE, which is the level. So this way we can able to generate the square wave of 50% duty cycle. So see here, with the help of this instruction, set B P1.0 and clear P1.0, we can able to generate the high bit or the 0 bit to the P1.0, and we introduce a delay subroutine in between them. So this way we can provide we can able to generate the square wave of the 50% duty cycle. Next, the JNB and JB instruction are widely used single bit operation. So we use instruction JNB and JB instruction, which is used for the single bit operation. So with the help of this JNB and JB instruction, we can also perform the single bit operation. They allow you to monitor a bit and make a decision depending on whether it's 0 or 1. So if you want to monitor a particular bit of whether it is the bit belongs to that particular port, so we can able to monitor this bit with the help of this instruction JB and JNP instruction. So these two instructions can be used for any bits of input output ports 0, 1, 2 and 3. Means we have four ports, that is port 0, port 1, port 2 and port 3 in 8051 microcontroller. Port 3 is typically not used for any input output, either single bit or byte wise operation, because port 3 will perform some additional operation. It will perform read and write operation, transmit and receive operation, interpolated operation. So the port 3, which is not generally used to perform the input output related operation. So this is required to remember, while all the ports, that is remaining port, that is port 0, port 1, port 2 can be used for the bitwise or bytewise related, single bit or bytewise related operation. So let's see the program. Write a program to perform the following. Keep monitoring the P1.2 bit until it becomes high. When P1.2 becomes high, write value 45 to port 0. Send a high to low pulse to P2.3. So with the help of this program, we need to perform following three operation. Keep monitoring the P1.2 bit. Then second is, when P1.2 becomes high, write value 45 to port 0, then send high to low pulse to P2.3. So here we need to monitor the P1.2 bit. So here we use instruction set B P1.2, make P1.2 as an input. So if we want to monitor the port P1.2 as an input, so with the help of this we can configure this P1.2 as an input, then move A comma hash 45H, the content of A is equals to 45H, then we keep monitoring this J with the help of instruction JNB P1.2. So here the since P1.2 as an input port, so we get out when P1.2 is equals to 1. So when this bit is not 1, the P1.2 is equals to not P1.2 is equals to 0, then it will keep monitoring it. When P1.2 is equals to 1, it will come out from the loop and it will transfer the value, that is A, to P0, then set P2.3, then clear P2.3. So this way we can able to perform these three tasks with the help of the following program. So if you want to monitor that, then we can configure this P1.2 as a input, then we will keep monitoring this P1.2 with the help of instruction JNB P1.2. So this is the use of JNP instruction. With the help of this JNP instruction, we can able to monitor the individual, a particular bit of port P1, second bit of 8051 microcontroller. In 8051 microcontroller, we have two timers, which is a 16-bit timer. There is timer 0 and timer 1. So the 8051 has two timers or counter. They can be used either as timer to generate a time delay or as event counter to count event happening outside the microcontroller. So in 8051 microcontroller, we have two timers. These timers can be designated as T0 and T1. Timer T0 and T1 can be used as a timer to generate a time delay or as an event counter to count event happening outside the microcontroller. So this is the use and this is the application of the timer of 8051 microcontroller. Both timer 0 and timer 1 are 16-bit wide. So this is important point. Both timer T0 and timer T1 are 16-bit wide. Since 8051 has 8-bit architecture, each 16-bit timer is accessed as two separate registers of low byte and high byte. So it is another important point in 8051 microcontroller. Since 8051 is an 8-bit architecture, so 16-bit timer can be accessed with the help of two separate registers, that is timer 0 low byte register and timer 0 high byte register, timer 1 low byte register and timer 1 high byte register. Timer T0 and T1 can be accessed as low byte and high byte timer register. So if I'm talking about timer 0 and timer 1 can be accessed as low byte and high byte register, the low byte register is called TL0 and TL1 and high byte register is called TH0 and TH1 register. So each timer, that is timer 0, having the 2 8-bit register, that is TL0. TL0 means it belongs to timer 0. It belongs to timer 0 and TH0 is also belongs to timer 0. So here this timer 0, which is a 16-bit register, this register can be divided into two parts, that is TL0 and TH0. The timer 0 low order register and timer 0 high order register. Similarly, timer 1, this is timer 1 TL1. And this is also for timer 1, TH1. Timer 1. So here this timer 1 is also divided into two parts, TL1 and TH1. So here the timers are divided into two 8-bit register, timer 0, TL0 and TH1, TL1 and TH1 register. So this register can be accessed separately because in 8051 microcontroller we know that the 8051 is 8-bit architecture. So accordingly the timers of the 8051, we need to divide this into two 8-bit register, that is TL0 and TH0, TL1 and TH1 register of 8051 microcontroller. Both timer 0 and 1 use the same register called TMOD register. So this TMOD is nothing but timer mod register to set the various timer operation mode. So if you want to use any timer of 8051, whether it is timer 0 and timer 1, we need to select this timer for the particular operation, whether we use to generate the timer for the delay operation or use this timer as for the event counter. So here these timers can be selected with the help of special register that is called TMOD register. TMOD register is nothing but timer mod register. The TMOD register is a 8-bit register. Remember that TMOD register is 8-bit register. The lower 4 bits are for timer 0 and the upper 4 bits are for timer 1. So this TMOD register is a 8-bit register, and in this 8-bit register the lower 4 bits which belongs to timer 0 and upper 4 bits which belongs to timer 1. So we can able to select the timer with the help of the corresponding bit which belongs to timer 0 and timer 1 for timer or counter related operation. In each case the lower 2 bits are used to set the timer mode and the upper 2 bits to specify the mode of operation. So here with the help of this TMOD register, see here this lower 2 bits, that is M0 and M1, these are used to select the mode of operation. M0 and M1 are used to select the mode of operation for timer 1, and M0 and M1 are used to select the mode of operation for timer 0. And here this is the gate signal which is used to provide the control, the external control, and we have this counter or timer related operation. With the help of that we can able to perform, we can use to set the timer for time delay operation or the counter operation. So this TMOD is very important register, which is 8-bit register, and with the help of that we can able to select the timer, that is timer 0 and timer 1 operation of the 8051 microcontroller. Let's see the TMOD register. So this TMOD register we have with the help of this 2 bits, that is M0, M1. We can able to select the operation. If both this M0 and M1 both are 00, that is a mode 0, which is 13-bit timer mode. If it is 01, it is a 16-bit timer mode. 16-bit timer counter THX and TL1 are cascaded. There is no prescaler. And if it is 10, then 8-bit auto reload mode, 8-bit auto reload timer counter THX hold a value that is to be loaded into TLX each time it overflows. So TX this, whether it is 0 or 1. If it is 0, it means it is related to the timer 0 operation. If it is 1, it is related to the timer 1 operation. And M1 is 1, M0 is 1, so this is mode 3 and it is split timer mode operation. So this is the physical structure of TMOD register, and with the help of that we can able to select the timer 0 for various mode of operation for the timer and counter related operation. Thank you very much.